So, good evening. Bienvenue à tous. I'm a professor. Let's go up. I'm Professor Masad Dama, chair of McGill Chemistry Department, and it's my pleasure to open the 2016 Lorne Trottier Public Science Symposium. As one of McGill premier annual events, this symposium is organized by our Office for Science and Society through the generous support of McGill engineering graduate Dr. Lorne Trottier. And it is particularly meaningful for me to represent the chemistry department because the Office of Science and Society actually was born 17 years ago as the Office for Chemistry and Society before Professor Harp, Fenster, Schwartz, and colleagues expanded their horizons to include all of science. Many of you have attended this symposium before, so you know you're in for two fascinating evenings. Science and the media is a very timely topic, given that we rely on reporters and commentators to interpret the complex world of scientific research for us, which, as you will hear from our speakers tonight and tomorrow night, can be quite a challenge. Now it is my honor to introduce the principal and vice chancellor of McGill University, Dr. Suzanne Fortier, to formally welcome you.
Bonsoir et bienvenue à vous tous. Merci d'être parmi nous pour ce symposium qui va sûrement être un événement très, très intéressant. J'aimerais aussi souhaiter la bienvenue à tous nos invités, nos conférenciers qui sont ici avec nous. It's always great at this time of the year to gather together here for the Trottier Symposium. It has become a tradition of the Montreal Fall and one of the great traditions. I want to take advantage of this time here to thank Lorne Trottier, Louise Roussel Trottier, and the whole Trottier clan who really are behind this symposium and have given us the support to bring us all together year after year. This year's lecture on science and the media, the challenge of reporting science responsibly, features four accomplished journalists, all of whom are highly skilled in communicating science to the public. There's something great about the time in which we live, of course. It's the age of information. Information about any topics we might be interested in is at our fingertips. But of course, it leaves us often with the difficulty of sorting out what is good information and what is not so good information. It is very difficult, unless you're a specialist in an area, to really figure out what you should see as reliable information and what is not. And of course, we can see that challenge in the titles of your four speakers. They use words such as spin, peddlers of bad science, age of bad information, and blurred lines between facts and fiction. So what they're telling us is that we need help. We need people who are gonna help us sort out in all of this information, the information that we really want to have, the reliable, trustworthy information. And we need help from our journalists. Increasingly, I think that their role as educators become more and more obvious. And I think we're very fortunate that we have people who are devoting their talent and their time to accompany us in a great journey through the scientific literature and the scientific sort of borderline literature. So this is going to be a great event, as we have seen over the years. And we are going to get it started without any further ado. And I'd like to introduce the moderator of today's symposium, Dr. Joe Schwartz, the director of McGill's Office for Science and Society. He's very well known for his public lectures on topics ranging from the truth about diets to the science of aging. And as you know, Joe has received many, many awards for his work in science promotion, in communicating science to the general public, as well as for teaching chemistry. Many of you listen to Joe on a regular basis as he has his own radio show on CGAD. It's called The Dr. Joe Show. Joe, please come to this podium.
Thank you, Principal Trottier. And as you heard, the topic tonight is very topical, the media. Trump. No, that isn't really it, but it certainly could have been. No, what we really are talking about here tonight is the information explosion. And it's all around us. We see it on our internet sites, we see it in our newspapers, in our magazines and radio, TV, etc. The amount of information out there is absolutely staggering. But what is difficult is to interpret that information, and the gap between the knowledge that we have and interpreting that is getting to be larger and larger. All science, of course, stems from the peer-reviewed scientific publications. But most people, of course, do not have access to that and would not be adept at reading it and interpreting it. So we do rely on the media to do that for us. But this is very, very challenging business. If you remember playing telephone when you were kids, you whisper something into one ear, and by the time it has gone through a few ears, it changes completely. And we experience this on a regular basis. When we see what appears on our media sites and then you look back to see the original publication, you see that there isn't always a perfect interpretation. And this can be dangerous, misinformation. We live in a tsunami of information which threatens to engulf us. And sometimes that can lead to difficulties. We have bloggers out there who have tremendous following, who have hundreds of thousands of people following them, even though they do not have the scientific background, but they have become the Pied Pipers because they offer simple solutions to complex problems. Yes, it's very charming to think that all of your health problems would be solved if only you would eat foods that contain ingredients that are monosyllabic, but it just doesn't work like that. But the problem is that such bloggers have a great deal of respect out there among the public. Time magazine has listed Vanni Harry, who has anointed herself the food babe, as one of the most influential people in science. That is a frightening thought when you have all kinds of good science communicators out there with solid backgrounds in science, but they are cast aside because she has captured the public's attention. There are all kinds of problems that we face statistically, and you will hear a great deal about that tomorrow night from Trevor Butterworth. The confusion between data as association and cause and effect. Many of you have seen graphs like this, from alarmists who point out that autism has risen in step together with glyphosate use. Glyphosate is known as Roundup. It's one of it is the most widely used herbicide in the world. And of course, it can be very compelling to look at a graph like that. But one could also show a graph, as you can see, linking autism to organic food sales. One can even show a graph linking it to cell phones or linking it to kale consumption. But of course, that doesn't get as much play. one of the biggest challenges in interpreting science is making sure that we're looking at cause and effect instead of association. But even the conventional press, the highly regarded press, does make some mistakes. This little article in Time magazine with the headline, "Brain Cancer Now Deadliest for Kids," I think would make people believe that there has been a frightening rise in brain cancer. Well, there actually has been a decrease in brain cancer, but the reason that we see this headline is because leukemia, which used to be the number one cancer that killed children, now has very, very good options for treatment. So if the number one cancer is being properly treated, then of course the number two rises to number one. Both of these cancers are actually decreasing, but that's not the message that you would get from the headline. Then we also have the problem of fraud. And if you take a look at this, it looks like it is authentic Forbes. Forbes is, of course, is a very, generally very trustworthy website. And Stephen Hawking supposedly talks about an ingredient in some dietary supplements that can increase your brain power. But in fact, this was not published in Forbes at all. And Forbes was very keen, of course, on their own website to point that out. We are buffeted about with information from all sides. And it is hard to know who to trust. I mean, one day we were told that vitamin C in mega doses is useless, and then you just go to another website and find out that it is the key to health and that it cures cancer. How do you know which one to trust? Well, we rely on reporters, we rely on the media, and we rely on them to help us separate the sense from the nonsense. And that is what we are going to try to do over the next two evenings with our four speakers. We will have some very different views on this because some of them come from the print media, some from the online media, and some from television. So we're going to get a glimpse behind the scenes of how all of this happens. Well, with that, let me introduce our first speaker, Julia Belluz. Julia is Canadian, and she's a graduate of Ryerson University, where she did a degree in journalism before doing a degree at the School of Economics in London. But her job right now is as a writer for Vox. And Vox is a large online, a digital newspaper, as it were. And this is the direction that information is heading these days. Everything is being done online. And Julia's going to give us a little bit of an insight into what it is like to write for Vox and what the challenges are. So, Julia.
Hello, everyone. Great to see you all here. There are many more of you than I expected, which makes me a little bit nervous, but also very happy that you all came out. I just want to say a very quick thank you to McGill, to Joe, to the Trottier family for their generosity and vision in bringing us all together today to talk about these very important issues. So I'm going to share with you today this five-step plan, five tools that I think can really help us in preventing and even fighting quackery that enters the media. But first, I wanted to share a little bit about how I became interested in health research evidence in journalism, because it's a little bit of a silly story, and I think if there's hope for me, there's hope for many of us here and people who are listening out there today. So about 6 years ago, I was a general assignment reporter in Toronto, and I was going on basically to take a bus to McMaster to report on a story. And while I was on this bus, I met a researcher, Stephen Hoffman, who's now at Ottawa, and he was then part of the biostatistics and epidemiology department at the university. And we started to talk about a lot of the things that Joe was just addressing. Why is you know, health media in such a sorry state. Why can journalists get away with coffee's good for you one day, bad the next, vaccines cause autism, and then they don't? These completely kind of flip-flopping, misleading headlines. And so he had theories about that. I had my own theories about how, you know, researchers like him didn't always answer my emails in time or my requests. He thought that journalists sometimes don't fully appreciate the nuances of how science works. And by the end of the ride, we basically both agreed that journalism and the media play such an important role in communicating things. So this is a little illustration of that. We have this world of research on one side, we have policy, practice, patients on the other side, and often we end up being the intermediaries and communicators of this knowledge, for better or worse. And as Joe was talking about, there's this incredible increase in the number of studies being done every year and the knowledge that's out there. So this is this little chart from PLOS Medicine where you see a 300-fold increase over the last 25 years, which is just phenomenal. And as we've discussed, not all of it's good information. So this is another little chart from Nature based on this BMJ article where you see a 9-fold increase in positive words being used in studies. So that's things like amazing, unprecedented, novel, groundbreaking. And the red line are negative words, and those only increase from 1.3% to 3.2%. So a much smaller increase in the more restrained language in journals. So there's a lot of blame to go around on all sides. And this fateful bus ride, meeting Stephen, it brought me into this world of these really nerdy and amazing researchers, and I use nerdy in a very generous, kind way. They were wonderful, and they're some of my patron saints of evidence-based thinking, including some other, I think, Trottier speakers who have spoken in the past. But they brought me into this world of evidence-based medicine and policy, and they were very generous with their time and taught me these basic concepts that I was amazed that, you know, I could get that far as a general assignment reporter and never learn any of this stuff. And it was things like how to read a study, how to tell, you know, how to critically appraise a study, how to tell whether it's well designed, that different studies have different limitations and we need to consider those when they're reporting on them. And so there were these very simple but very powerful lessons, and they ended up changing how I report and really how I see the world. So when I would see studies that came across my desk after that, or when my mother would call and say, you know, Dr. Oz said this on TV today, and maybe you need to consider getting your thyroid checked or whatever it was, I became much more skeptical and started to ask for evidence. And so I think this whole interaction with these researchers, it really helped me see how we in the media play this pivotal role in, we can either lead people astray, or when science reporting is done right, I think we have this absolutely tremendous opportunity, and we can help translate the best of what's known in research, hold people accountable, including scientists when they misuse and abuse research, or when there's, you know, cardiothoracic surgeons like Dr. Oz who aren't always maybe, you know, who are sometimes misusing and abusing science. And so I want to talk tonight about what I think is that tremendous opportunity, how we can really help, how we in the media and also concerned citizens and researchers, how we can really work together and help people navigate, as Joe said, this tsunami of health misinformation. So I have a plan, and it's called ISIS. I can assure you it has nothing to do with the terrorist group, but it's about... So there's 5 steps: infiltrate, shame, contextualize, educate, and sympathize. And some of the things that I'm going to talk about, they've gotten me blacklisted from the Dr. Oz show. As we were talking today, all of us have similar war stories, subject of legal threats. I helped to get an anti-vaccine story retracted from one of the largest newspapers in North America. But most importantly, they've really helped me see how much of a powerful and impactful tool science media can be. So the first plan, I couldn't escape this. I've been living in Washington, so you have to let me at least reference the election once. So infiltrating. So this is really about basically reaching into communities that we might not otherwise reach with science and science-minded reporting. So it's about avoiding preaching to the converted, which I think we're very often guilty of in the science media. So allow me to draw on this this example from the election, or from one of the, I think, the most sympathetic characters who features in the background of this election, and that's Michelle Obama. So she has, how many, do people here know her Let's Move campaign against childhood obesity? Okay, so she's been kind of waging this multi-pronged awareness campaign, and then behind the scenes also helping to move policy through about fighting childhood obesity. And she's this incredibly gifted communicator, and she has her messaging about gardening and about eating well and exercising going across like everything from Instagram to YouTube to Facebook to TV shows like Sesame Street and Ellen and Twitter. And she's basically, instead of just, you know, maybe going through some of the obvious channels, she's really trying to meet people where they are, where they're already gathering on these various media channels and getting her message across. And she's had this real success. So not only, you know, bringing the public discourse around to childhood obesity, which is not something that really featured as prominently 8 years ago, but she's also been helping to move policy around transparency in food labels and cleaning up the food supply. And I think we have a lot to learn from her. If we want to think about fighting quackery and promoting evidence-based thinking and you know, raising awareness about how science works, we need to get creative about reaching out and thinking about not just, you know, preaching to the people who already think like us, but also reaching out across different communities who might not think like us. And so at Vox, we have we're very lucky. When we publish a big story, we can work with different teams in the newsroom to think about how to translate this feature onto a Snapchat story, onto a YouTube video. For example, this summer, we published a big feature on why exercise, while it's fantastic for so many things, it's almost the closest thing we can have to a miracle pill, and I don't use that term lightly, especially not to this audience, but it's not very good for that particular endpoint of weight loss. And so this feature explained that, all the science of, oops, why that is, but it also, we explained why, how the food industry often distorted that message and how they often promoted exercise as this quick route to slimming, even though it's really actually not, and it's food that matters in that equation. So I was really lucky to work with our Snapchat team. How many people know Snapchat or use Snapchat in this audience? Because I hardly use it too personally, but we promoted it, we turned it into this little Snapchat feature where, you know, I think it's mostly teens on there sexting each other and whatnot or whatever it is, but we reached them with this message about how food could distort the message about, you know, obesity and exercise, and we reached the audiences on YouTube with a video, and many of them, I think, were exposed to ideas that they wouldn't have been exposed to otherwise. And I think infiltrating these new communities and exposing different people to science, I think the onus is also on researchers to do that. I was very, very inspired by this researcher I met from the London School of Medicine and Tropical Hygiene this summer, and he said early in his career, he would usually only, you know, reach out to reporters at The Guardian or the BBC, these very well-established, well-trusted, usually accurate media outlets on science. And now he's made a point to mainly talk to reporters at the Daily Mail, outlets like the Mirror, the Mail, these places that aren't very well associated with rigorous scientific coverage, because he thinks they'll benefit much more from that interaction. So, I think that's one step, infiltrating and thinking about how to infiltrate these different communities. The next step that I think is really effective is shame. And this is really about holding the enablers of quackery to account. So not just necessarily debunking and going after the quacks, but also their enablers. So this is a tweet from the Toronto Star from last February. And back then, the Star people here follow this? It was a controversy where they published essentially a front page feature suggesting that the HPV vaccine was harming and maiming young women. And if anyone who's reported on vaccines or on public health knew that actually the science, right, at least that we know right now, that this is not a harmful vaccine, and they had misinterpreted a vaccine adverse events reporting database. So when I first saw this story, I wrote emails to the editor, the editor on the story and some of the reporters, just saying, hey, like, I think there's some errors and misstatements here you might want to correct. And then I got no reply. And so after a few days of this story being online, this chorus of concern swelled up. Public health researchers were getting engaged and saying, hey, Toronto Star, wake up, you need to do something. Doctors, different members of the medical community. And so I forwarded, I basically reached out to a friend there. She suggested I send my email to the editor in chief. And so I did that. And in return, I got these terribly demeaning emails, the paper's editor writing to me, and I quote, stop gargling our bathwater and take the energy to run yourself your own fresh tub, which was kind of shocking and surprising at the time. And it became quick, and it wasn't just me, it was other well-meaning critics who were reaching out and getting very similar responses. So it became clear pretty quickly that they had not only run this erroneous story, but they seemed to be in denial about it or just not willing to kind of acknowledge the impact this misreporting could have. So I decided to write about this incident in Vox and explain, you know, use it as an example to explain why anecdotes aren't representative of all the reams of data we have on the HPV vaccine and different things about this adverse events reporting database for vaccines. And I also explained in the story how decision makers at the Star were responding to critics. And this ended up getting picked up by the CBC. It got picked up in other national newspapers in Canada, in the Washington Post, in the LA Times. And the result was that the Star, to its credit, ended up issuing a very rare retraction of the story and taking it offline, which doesn't happen often in media at all. And it started a discussion about the importance of the HPV vaccine and the fact that it is indeed a safe and seemingly life-saving vaccine. And the principle I was working off there was one I've borrowed from another Trottier Symposium speaker, Ben Goldacre, who's a British physician and author. And he's the one who said, you can't just go after the quacks. You need to hold their enablers account. You need to hold the people who are giving them a platform, to account. And the way he puts it was that no one hates having their name in the paper as much as journalists, editors, and broadcasters, and even policymakers, because we're used to hiding in the shadows, quite frankly. We're not used to being out there named and shamed. And so it's not a friendly tool, but I think it's a powerful one when there's a, you know, someone to hold to account for misusing and abusing science. So the third principle of ISIS, not the terrorist group, is context. Putting cranks into context, not overstating their influence. So I faced this challenge when a couple of years ago when Vani Hari, the food babe, who's made several appearances at this conference already, for good reason, her book appeared on my desk. And so she essentially takes chemicals, as Joe explained, and talks about how they're slowly killing us all, these like silent, slow killers. And she's built her brand around this. And the book was total malarkey, like it was just reeked of pseudoscience. And I thought, okay, we're not going to cover this. And I threw it aside. And sure enough, within, I don't know, a few months later, there were stories about her, as Joe mentioned, appearing in the Times, appearing in the Atlantic. She was being called the next Dr. Oz, which, of course, raised alarm bells. So she was now impossible to ignore. And so we ended up covering her, but we did it in context. We explained that hers are pretty much fringe theories, that the science is pretty much monolithically stacked against her. We pointed out how she was preying and taking advantage on people's confusion and fear around food and chemicals. And we use the same, I think it's the same principle that you'd use for covering a climate change or vaccine denier. You'd ask, you know, is this person really prominent enough to warrant a story? And then are we giving a, you know, a platform to a fringe, like a lunatic with fringe theories? And then if you do go ahead, you need to explain, you know, the weight of science and how it kind of measures up or how it's stacked against them. With a vaccine denier, maybe you'd point out that the vast majority of parents, they're doing the right thing. They're vaccinating their kids. So I think that context is absolutely essential in these types of stories and reporting. So this is my favorite idea, and it's about education. I think even when we do our best to tell these well-contextualized stories, to put everything into context and, you know, hold the quack enablers to account, we don't always succeed. There's very good evidence from Dartmouth's Brendan Nehan, and he's shown that it's really difficult to actually change people's opinions with corrective information. So once we hold these beliefs and opinions about, he's looked at politics, vaccine denier, or people who are skeptical of vaccines, it can be very difficult to correct that. And so I think one of the best ideas I've come across is to figure out how to educate kids when they're really young. And there's a group that's working on this right now I think they deserve absolute credit for what they're doing. So one of the leaders on this study that's happening now in Uganda is one of the co-founders of the Cochrane Collaboration, Ian Chalmers. And basically they've taken 15,000 kids at I don't know how many hundred schools, and they've run a randomized trial where half of the kids get an intervention, and that intervention is education in critical thinking skills. So they're teaching them a lot of the basic things that I referred to at the beginning of the talk, how to look for conflicts of interest. You know, is this health claim based on an anecdote or good evidence? They're teaching them, like, you know, to sum it up, the best quote I think is from Chalmers. They're teaching children to, quote, detect bullshit when bullshit is being presented to them. They've designed these teaching materials. So this is one of the cartoons in their workbooks that the kids are using. And they're still in the process of analyzing the results. So we actually don't know whether they're going to be effective or not, whether they're going to be able to increase kids' awareness about how to assess the reliability of medical claims. But I think no matter whether or not the trial fails or succeeds, it's almost beside the point, because they're getting closer to what I think we should all be working toward, and that's how do you create effective educational interventions on these skills that, quite frankly, it's amazing we don't all learn very early in life. So we'll have the results, I think, in the next few months from them, and it'll be super interesting to see. So the S in ISIS is about sympathizing, or the last S in ISIS, from shame to sympathy. So I think this is one of the underutilized skills when it comes to kind of fighting quackery and pseudoscience. Sometimes we really forget to ask, you know, why do they hold the beliefs they hold? Why do they feel that way? Very often it's people who are, you know, maybe they're science-minded, they're educated, and they still hold beliefs that aren't consistent with research evidence. And there's good reasons for that I think the media could do a lot much better job in trying to understand those. So this became very clear in some of the reporting I was doing on vaccines around, do you remember in a couple of years ago, there was a big measles outbreak in California at Disneyland? So around this time, all these stories started to emerge about, you know, these Marin County mothers and granola crunching hippies in California who are denying vaccines and suggesting that this is the thing that's really sparked the measles outbreak. But when you looked at the research, I very quickly learned that the biggest recent measles outbreak in US history had happened in an Amish community in Ohio. So it turned out that there was a missionary in one of these communities that had gone over to the Philippines, got measles, came back to his community where people were unvaccinated and sparked a giant outbreak in Ohio. And I called the Amish, which is not easy, calling the Amish. And you have to call them at their place of work. That's the trick. But I learned that it wasn't vaccine denialism, it wasn't their religion, but it was someone in their community allegedly had been harmed by a vaccine at some point. This spread generations of fear within this community, and they were refusing vaccines. Around that time, we ran this other story about a different movement called the vaccine delayers. And so these are different from outright anti-vaxxers. They're people who often they're educated And they are making up their own vaccine schedules based on, there's a tremendously popular book called The Vaccine Book. It has a benign name, but it's not. It's basically, it's basically a how-to guide for parents to selectively vaccinate their children and create their own vaccine schedules. But what I learned from those parents was that actually, it's not that crazy that we ask young parents to subject their kids to dozens of needles. These kids are otherwise healthy. The parents have never seen the diseases that they're preventing. And, people have, their fears aren't completely unfounded. These were really reasonable people. And I think this learning these things, I hope that it helped me to communicate to health professionals who might meet patients like this, and maybe they'll be better equipped to talk to them, or policymakers who need to think about special programs to reach these communities who have their own unique reasons for being fearful of vaccines. So that's ISIS. And I just want to end on this quote. Science is not a major or a career. It's a commitment to a systematic way of thinking. I love this quote from Atul Gawande in The New Yorker. And it just reminds me of what these generous folks at McMaster, these other people who are working on knowledge translation, who are working on the trials in Uganda to figure out how to teach children critical thinking skills. You know, you can be a journalist interested in making sure that science isn't just being completely misrepresented and abused and used for harm in the media. You can be a researcher thinking about how to teach kids to become little BS detectors. I hope that we could appreciate this importance of asking for evidence and how far scientific thinking can get us in communicating that to our audiences. So I hope this 5-step plan can help us identify some of those opportunities and that you'll all find it useful wherever you're go off to after tonight. And I think after this, later on tonight, we're going to take questions after Erica's talk. Thank you so much.
I've been told to tell you that the hashtag for tonight, for those of you who tweet or make any other bird sound, is Trottier 2016. Trottier 2016. Okay, let me just get the next one up here. Erica Johnson, to Canadians, really doesn't need an introduction. Erica has hosted Marketplace, which is Canada's premier investigative reporting show, for 15 years. And her background is as a journalist. She did a degree from Ryerson in Toronto. Before Marketplace, she was on The Health Show. And she is now on to other things at CBC. But Marketplace, of course, has made a huge mark on Canadian society. 15 years of investigative reporting. And she's going to regale us with some stories from behind the scenes. So, Erica Johnson. So, this is forward, back, and when you play, you'll have to get on.
Yes, great, thank you. Well, first of all, thank you so much to Joe and to McGill, to the Lorne Trottier family for hosting tonight. It is an honor to be here talking about the challenge of reporting science responsibly. And, you know, I think perhaps these days the most challenging rejection of science that we've seen has been the denial of human-induced climate change. Fortunately, much of that climate denial has been repudiated, and most politicians no longer speak of it, except for perhaps one of the more notable candidates in the US presidential election, who does not believe climate change is human-induced. But as Stephen Colbert has said, the facts have a liberal bias. But I am not looking at environment science today. I'm going to take a look at how we report health stories responsibly. And the topic of my talk is busting the spin cycle. And I have to thank the body of evidence guys for pulling together this snazzy graphic, because I came without one. So I appreciate that. As you know, journalists are inundated with press releases constantly announcing the latest, greatest, everything. New healthcare products, new pharmaceuticals, a magic pill that melts away fat, a cream that will dissolve your wrinkles. All of these very sparkly health-related developments with greater or lesser science behind them, and all in the spin cycle vying for media attention. We also know that alternative health treatments are growing in popularity, not just in Canada, but around the world. And more, I think, you know, you have to ask yourself, why is that? And largely, I think it's because more and more of us want control over our health. We want to have input into what's happening in our bodies. We want to have conversations about our health. That often takes time, and too often in the conventional world of medicine, things are rushed. Doctors might not have the best bedside manner. They can be paternalistic. And so you can see how attractive it might be to explore another world far from mainstream health. And studies, too, have shown that, never mind the treatment prescribed, that just having that one-on-one FaceTime with an alternative healthcare practitioner can, in fact, make you feel not just psychologically better, but physically better. There is a benefit to having that personal time. Add to that the fact that a lot of pseudoscience uses feel-good language about products or treatments. You know, they say they are natural, they're drug-free, they have no side effects, making them very easy to embrace. And we know, too, that there's sometimes reason to be skeptical of big pharma and the influence that it wields in the world of health, which makes looking at alternative treatments, again, even more appealing. And so I see our job as health and science reporters as gatekeepers for the public. We should be putting scientific claims under scrutiny, and we should be reporting on those that hold up, but busting also those that don't. You know, the constant cycle of these bogus health claims and snake oil salesmen peddling their wares, I think the part of our job is not just to not cover those things, but to explain and to expose why they are potentially dangerous. So I recently began hosting an investigative news segment called Go Public, where members of the public write us at the CBC about wrongdoing. And that can run the gamut. It can be, often it's health related. My colleague, Rosa Marcatelli, who also works on Go Public, recently filed a story about a dentist here in Quebec who had a patient die in his chair. I see you're nodding, you know the story. So he decided to become a foot doctor instead of being a dentist. And then not only that, he decided to create his own foot implants, homemade devices, medical devices not approved by Health Canada. However, now, since the coverage, Health Canada is investigating. But until a few months ago, before Go Public, I was hosting Marketplace, as Joe mentioned, which is CBC's investigative consumer show. And it's a show that I'm going to focus on tonight, on the work that we did there. Because I think Marketplace holds a very unique and a privileged position within the world of journalism, and certainly in broadcasting in Canada. It's North America's only national investigative program. It's the longest running current affairs show in Canada. And it has what I think is an incredible mandate to expose wrongdoing and to hold corporations and governments accountable. So it's real estate that comes with a fair amount of responsibility. And to its credit, it's developed quite a large following, about 1 million viewers every week when it is on. It starts in 2 weeks is the new season. So one area that I've reported on quite a bit for Marketplace is the world of, alternative health treatments, is because they're becoming increasingly popular and they're not all benign. So the first topic that I remember first learning about in this field was homeopathy. And it claims to use highly effective remedies with no side effects. So you can see why that would be appealing. Hard to see how that can make sense, but it is appealing. So we decided to take our first look at this alternative treatment about 5 years ago because we were getting a lot of interest from viewers asking about this. The Ontario government was looking at regulating homeopathy. And so we looked into it, and I have to admit that I did not know a lot about homeopathy at the time. I'd heard about it. I'd seen products in natural health food stores and in drug stores. But I didn't know that it is essentially based on this crazy belief that the more you dilute a medicine or an active ingredient, the more powerful it becomes. And I remember a story meeting where the producer and I were meeting with our executive producer and a few other people on the team, and we said, so we want to do this story. We've been looking into homeopathy, and here's how it works. And people were staring at us at the table saying, no, that can't be right. You guys, go back and do more research. Like, the more you dilute something, the more powerful it becomes. That's not the belief. You must be reading the wrong books. And in fact, we had it right. That is the science behind homeopathy, so we decided to look into it. And so we thought, well, how do we demonstrate to our viewers that homeopathy is nothing but sugar pills? So we followed a group in Vancouver called the Vancouver Skeptics, who were more than willing to stand outside Vancouver General Hospital's emergency room and overdose on pills of homeopathic remedies. So entire bottles of arsenic they would chug, and we would wait every 15 minutes, and luckily they were outside the emergency room at a hospital in case something happened. But, you know, nothing happened, and 30 minutes later, nothing happened. They downed more, and they were just consuming bottles and bottles of these little pills. And so, of course, all they really got was a sugar high because they'd eaten all this sugar. But it was a good visual demonstration that they weren't being affected by these remedies. So we were having a little bit of fun doing that, but then we decided to use science to actually deconstruct what's in a homeopathic remedy. So we bought two remedies for different things. We brought the vials of pills to the University of Toronto, and we had a guy who had this huge machine, I mean, it was ginormous, in his lab, and it had the ability to analyze the ingredients of the pills down to 1/1,000,000 of a gram. And then after the test came out, I said, okay, so what'd you find? You know, which product is which? And he said, the profiles are identical. There's no difference between treatment A and remedy B. We did detect sugar. That's it. And so once we had that information, here's what we did next. Figure this out. That's this one. So to get some answers, we head to a Vancouver conference on homeopathy and meet up with Boiron manager Carolyn Smoyer. These are being sold as two different products with two different ingredients in them, but we couldn't find anything more than sugar in them. So are you just selling sugar pills?
No, we're selling homeopathic medicines. Perhaps science hasn't developed to the point where we have the equipment and the technology fine enough to be able to detect these very diluted substances.
But if they are so diluted that we don't even have the equipment yet to be able to detect these substances, how can that have an effect on the body? We're talking about Nothing. He looked at 1/1,000,000 of a gram in these products and couldn't detect anything.
Yes, homeopathy is somewhat of a mystery, but again, we know that it works.
Time and again, believers in homeopathy talk about mystery, the unknown and unexplainable.
Don't you wonder how these products might work?
There hasn't been a lot of demand for clinical studies, again, because of it being a traditional medicine.
Right? I mean, need I say more? You get somebody like this who says it's a mystery. We haven't done any clinical trials because nobody's asked us to. Later in the interview, she says, well, you guys, the world hasn't developed the technology yet capable of measuring active ingredients in homeopathic remedies. So, I think that's the beauty of television and marketplace. That she represents Warren, the largest manufacturer of homeopathic remedies in the world, and she's still going, just buy it, it's a mystery. It's very, very powerful. And, we can laugh and roll our eyes, but this system of alternative healthcare isn't just selling sugar pills to people for 10, 15, 20 bucks. A bottle. As we poked around on homeopathic websites, we saw claims that it could be used to treat cancer. And so one of the things that we do on Marketplace often is that we will make phone calls on camera to sort of bust the spin cycle and let the viewer in on our research as we're going along our journey. So take a look at this call.
Homeopathy for cancer? Really? Sure enough, we find amazing claims on Canadian homeopath websites. Claims that diseases like breast cancer, prostate, and liver cancer can all be treated. So we call up a clinic, tell the homeopath about a friend with breast cancer.
It's a stage one cancer, and some cells have moved into neighboring tissue. Is that still something you could help with?
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. That our medicines work, okay? Because we boost the immune system.
Okay. How quickly do you think this might work?
Maybe 15 days, I'm thinking right now.
15 days, what?
Yeah.
What would happen?
I'm going to give some medicine. We're going to boost the immune system, and we're going to see maybe the cancer cells are dissolving or burning in the body. You don't even felt, but when they do the ultrasound and do the CT scan, they will see that, okay, cancer cells are going, right?
Within so 2 weeks?
Within 2 weeks. That's what I'm telling you. First stage, in 2 weeks, we could help.
That's absolutely shocking, and it's clearly bogus. And there's absolutely no evidence to back that up whatsoever.
Dr. Steven Sager is a leading cancer specialist who thinks there's no place for homeopathy in cancer treatment.
At the very best, I think it's sad. At the worst, I think it's a total scam. A delay in visiting a conventional evidence-based cancer center is a delay in treatment, and a delay in treatment can have very serious results.
So, thank God for science and for experts who are willing to do television. That's something that we do on our show, is that we will reveal some quackery, and then we'll take our findings to someone who has some science behind them to explain what they've just seen, what we've just showed our viewers, and what the potential dangers are. So after that phone call that I made to the homeopath saying 2 weeks to start treating cancer, we started calling around to various homeopathic organizations, asking for comment, telling them what we'd found, inviting them to try to explain to us what was going on. The Homeopathic Medicine Council of Canada was the only organization that agreed to talk. And during that interview, he also said, yeah, I can use homeopathy. It has been used before to cure cancer. And not just treat cancer, to cure it. We asked for studies that would prove it, and he did send us quite a few studies, but when we had them analyzed, none of them proved anything. That the studies were poorly done, poorly conceived, they weren't double blind, the investigators had a bias. So it really calls into question the validity of homeopathy, and it makes you wonder why Health Canada has issued licenses for over 6,000 homeopathic remedies in Canada alone. So I was recently asked, in preparation for this talk, somebody called up and did a little interview and asked if I thought that all science reporters should have a science background. I don't have a science background, and I said that it would certainly be helpful to have one, but thankfully we have other folks in universities and hospitals and et cetera to help us through our research. We do have to know what questions we should be asking. I think There are people that times in this job where it would have been helpful to have a science degree, and I'm thinking of one of the most memorable for me, also most outlandish stories that I ever covered, which was a device invented by a Canadian that cured cancer, supposedly. The device was called the electrophysiofeedback xroid. There's a name for you, or the EPFX. And it was being demoed at fairs like the PNE and community events, and online you could go into clinics and workshops and learn how to use the EPFX, which was basically a laptop with these bands that wrapped around your wrist and your headband and your ankles. And in the story, I go and I get an EPFX treatment, which the producers loved because I looked like an idiot with the straps all over me, and so on and so forth. But we had people writing our show telling us that their loved ones were using this device, in some cases to treat cancer, and that they had questions about it, and so could we investigate? So we had never heard of the EPFX before. After poking around a bit on the internet, we learned that the inventor had sold 20,000 of these devices, that there were people that were being trained up every week, and that there were places that we could drop in to learn more about it. So we decided to send a producer along with someone who actually had cancer to a session to find out how this device could help them. And what they heard in this session was that it used energy medicine, which of course is a pseudoscience, practice that's mistakenly believed to be based in science. And the problem with the internet is that as people use it more and more, we've also seen a rise in pseudoscientific concepts. And so when your treatment is on the internet, it gives validity to notions, really, to beliefs with no basis for fact. You can create a website for your quackery, you can reference poorly done studies, you can use terms that are essentially scientifically meaningless, but they sound really good. You can add emotion and exclamation points and throw in a few testimonials, and now the product that you're selling, in this case the EPFX, suddenly looks very credible. So during we decided to send this producer in with somebody who has cancer, and they were wearing a hidden camera, which is another device that we use on Marketplace, and we don't do that lightly. There's a lot of discussion that goes into, is this necessary? Is there any other way that we are able to obtain this footage? Because it is a violation of privacy, and we often face criticism for taking our cameras into certain places. It has to go up the chain at the CBC before we get approval for hidden camera. But we did in this case, and what our producer and the fellow with cancer were told was that yes, EPFX could treat his cancer, but it can also cure AIDS, Parkinson's, Alzheimer's. I mean, it was this miracle device. And so we asked the Canadian inventor what scientific evidence he had to back up these claims. And of course, we heard nothing for weeks and weeks and weeks. So we started wrapping up our story. We were in editing. One day, boxes started to arrive of studies on biofeedback and electromagnetic energy treatments, just boxes and boxes and boxes of them, and newspaper studies. People had actually written about this in a non-critical way, and they were clearly trying to bury us in paper. It was just a heck of a job going through them, casting aside easily the ones that were just anecdotal, and then sending others off to biofeedback experts to analyze to see if there was any possible way that some biofeedback wave could trigger a change in your body, and therefore if there was any sort of remote chance that this thing worked. And one of the more memorable studies I remember we were reading was about a woman who had cancer in her arm, and she claimed in this anecdotal report that she got a treatment by an EPFX device and was grocery shopping and pushing her cart, and the cancer, the tumor, just fell out of her arm. And we howled when we read that, but we were exhausted because we were going through all these studies. And it was like 1 a.m, and we thought, well, could it? No, a tumor can't just fall out of your. This is ridiculous, So we ended up getting an interview with this inventor, Canadian inventor, who had now moved to Budapest. And he was living in a mansion. He had security guards, security cameras. He had a staff of about 12, a chauffeur, a hairdresser, because he also liked to dress as a woman, and he had this alter ego. He was Desiree Dubonnet when we showed up. And I interviewed her, and she pointed to a gun on the coffee table and said, "Don't make me use this." So, you know, we sort of went, "I think that's a replica." The producer and the cameraman and I were looking around for exits, and he had his own television crew with him documenting this whole thing. And needless to say, it was a very, very tense situation. At one point, she turned to her own camera crew and started calling me an agent of Big Pharma and, yelling at me, and the whole thing just sort of fell apart, which made for good television. But, it's scary to think of all the people that were relying on energy medicine, and that this device was licensed by Health Canada. Our story featured a woman, we interviewed her husband. She had passed away relying on the EPFX. She may have died from her cancer had she tried other conventional treatments. We just don't know because she didn't opt for them. So very sad. I should say the upshot of our story was that 3 days after it aired, Health Canada pulled the license for the EPFX. It can no longer be sold in this country. So yay, chalk one up. But meantime, there are hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of other biofeedback devices that have been licensed by Health Canada with scant research behind them. And I'm going to get to what Health Canada licenses in just a few minutes. So I mentioned that we sometimes use hidden cameras for our investigations because some stories are harder to get at the heart of them. You know, you can interview as many experts as you like, and you can read as many studies, but there are parts of the alternative health world that go on behind closed doors, and really the only way to see what's happening there is using hidden cameras. And so that was the case for our investigation into vaccines. Vaccine rates are falling in Canada and in the US in some communities, and we're seeing a lot of preventable diseases slowly making a comeback, like whooping cough and measles. BC had the largest measles outbreak 2 years ago, I believe it was, that it had seen in 30 years. So when we looked into these falling vaccination rates, we learned that a lot of parents were being discouraged from vaccinating their kids when they visited alternative healthcare providers. And beyond that, there was one group of practitioners, homeopaths, that were also offering an alternative treatment to conventional vaccines. So, you know, we know that a lot of parents, I'm a parent, we all grapple with, you know, our kids' health and the best way to protect them. And we want what's best for our kids. We worry about any treatment or procedure that we're going to subject them to. And when it comes to vaccines, there's a lot of contradicting information out there. I should say that contradicting information is largely on the internet, on websites, in chat rooms, on personal blogs, and that these often have celebrities weighing in on the vaccine debate. And so it's little wonder that parents are confused, even though, you know, there's very little scientific debate about the true value of childhood vaccines. We know that they are safe and effective, and they aren't linked to diseases like autism. So the science on homeopathic vaccine alternatives is equally unequivocal. They don't offer any protection. Even the Canadian Homeopathic Pharmaceutical Association doesn't recommend using alternatives in lieu of conventional vaccines, which is odd. Your national body is saying, here are these alternative vaccines, but we don't recommend you use them in lieu of the conventional vaccines. So when we looked at the websites of some Canadian homeopaths, we saw that they were not only offering vaccine counseling, but some of them were offering these vaccine alternatives. So for this story, we made appointments with 5 Canadian homeopaths who offered these vaccine consultations, and we sent in moms with their babies. Not reporters, real moms with their, even though reporters can be real people too that have babies, but we sent in non-reporter moms with babies, and one of our researchers went with them wearing a hidden camera to document what they were told, and here's what we heard.
The babies settle in. And Natalie is 10 months old.
And it doesn't take long for almost all of the homeopaths to raise concerns about vaccines.
Babies are getting too much stimulation of their immature immune systems. We see so many children, unlike when I was a child, with peanut allergies, with egg allergies, with eczema.
In two different appointments, Emma's told the number of shots kids get today is overwhelming their immune systems.
We're having, you know, 26 vaccinations by the time we're there two now. We're creating a real generation of sickly kids.
We show vaccine expert Shannon McDonald.
Is there any truth to that?
It's quite the opposite, actually. So the number of vaccines are more, but we've refined vaccines to the point that the actual, shall we say, the germs, the antigens that are put into the child's arm are at a much lower number.
Next, 4 out of 5 take a shot at a shot every kid's supposed to get, the MMR vaccine for measles, mumps, and rubella.
Some kids, I think, are sensitive, and autism may be something they develop because of MMR or not.
Incredibly, these homeopaths tell Emma and Katie vaccines could cause autism.
There's also other vaccines that could cause autism, not just MMR.
In one appointment, then another.
I mean, I don't see a lot of autistic kids, but the autistic kids I see, their parents are fairly confident that their children are vaccine damaged.
Really?
Yeah. Vaccine damaged?
I mean, autism is an epidemic at this point in time. Yeah. And, you know, all the official studies say, well, it's not related to vaccination, and yet you just can't...
McDonald can't believe the autism myth based on a discredited study is alive and well.
That whole study has been completely debunked, but it planted the seed of doubt in parents' minds, and it's hard to unscare people.
You know, and I see you watching and sort of laughing and, oh, isn't that crazy what they're saying, maybe preaching to the converted, but if you're a parent with a new mom and you're in that situation and that's what you're hearing, that, I think, is very, very scary. So again, what we do is we reveal something and then we show our findings to an expert. And I just think there's so much value in being able to capture what's actually going on behind closed doors, to hear homeopaths say these things about vaccines, that's a very effective way to try to bust the spin cycle. So, you know, we demonstrated that homeopaths were warning parents away from conventional vaccines, but we also experienced them selling homeopathic alternatives. So during these visits, they take out vials of sugar pills, and they say that they're remedies to prevent measles, rubella, whooping cough, etc. And here's how effective they say they are.
We're visiting homeopaths, listening in on the advice they're giving moms, Katie and Emma, about vaccinating their kids.
Hi, nice to meet you.
So far, what we hear is alarming.
I really would urge you to put off any further vaccination until he's older.
Almost all the homeopaths tell our undercover parents vaccination could be dangerous.
There's a lot of risk with vaccines.
Only one doesn't raise concerns about risks.
Yeah, that's not my area.
And check out what this homeopath is about to show us.
This is what a remedy looks like. It's just a little ball, and it's just like sugar. It tastes really good.
A homeopathic alternative they all offer, say, is risk-free.
These are the medicated potencies.
And claim is just as effective as vaccination.
Would it be the same protection as
From the studies that have been done, it's no different.
Okay. Yeah. How safe would he be?
93% to 96% effective.
92.4% efficacy.
92.4, so, you know, they're pretty specific about how effective these sugar pills. I love it when she says, oh, they taste like sugar. I wonder why. So as we always do on the show, after we've done Hidden Camera, we reach out to the people on camera and we tell them what we found. We give them an opportunity to do an interview with us to contextualize that conversation. And none of them, nobody agreed to speak with us. And we also contacted every major pharmaceutical or homeopathic organization and asked if anybody would appear on camera. Nobody would. One of the homeopaths featured in our piece did remove vaccine consultation services from her website. So who knows if those are still happening or not. And you know, we did get quite a bit of heat after this story, just a lot of criticism about going into a private consultation, although the mom with the baby was in on it, so you know, we weren't violating giving out any health information that she wasn't comfortable with. And I will say, if you don't like what we found, please give us your side of it. And they all refused. So I mentioned that celebrities have weighed in on the vaccine debate, and I'd like to touch on the culture of celebrity influencing so much of the conversation around health these days. The link between vaccines and autism was revived by actress Jenny McCarthy, and when her son became autistic after he became vaccinated. And more we see things like Dr. Oz and his three-day detox cleanse being championed, and there's Dr. McCullough, who's got all kinds of alternative ideas that he's peddling. And you know, these are people. Dr. Oz is a cardiothoracic surgeon. You know, he did not send away cereal box tops for his medical degree, so he has a lot of credibility when he speaks out, and that really is unfortunate because it lends to his credibility that gets lent to a cause. Here in Canada, as far as celebrity goes in Canada, we have one of the biggest names backing a supposed cold remedy that has no scientific evidence that it works, and that is hockey commentator Don Cherry. You know, he was a paid spokesperson for Cold FX, which claimed to reduce the frequency, severity, and duration of a cold. It's manufactured from ginger. And we decided to take a look at it because it's so popular. You know, you go into any drugstore in any Canadian city and you're going to see Cold FX front and forward and center and forward. And back in the pharmacy, we had pharmacists tell us on hidden camera, well, I recommend Cold FX. Because this product has taken a step that most natural health products have not, and that is it has conducted its own clinical trials, a number of them. And so then it points to, well, we've got clinical trials to warrant all of these claims that we're making. And, you know, even without these clinical trials, you could still put clinically proven on your packaging. But that's neither here nor there. And so one of the hallmarks of our show, Marketplace, is testing. So whether it's a hidden camera test that we do or a test of our own, in the Cold FX case, we had it analyzed. It was ginseng. Some of it was contaminated. But actually, our analysis did not find that. We had an insider at Cold FX give us reports showing contamination in the product, and Health Canada confirmed that there was contamination. But what we did for Cold FX was we did a meta-analysis. We asked two different experts, two different institutions, to take a look at the research and to tell us whether this could prevent the severity or duration or frequency of a cold. And what we found was that none of the studies do that. All the clinical trials studied what happens if you take Cold FX every single day for the cold and flu season. So if you were to take a pill for between 2 and 6 months, you would prevent one cold every 17 years. That's what the data found. And so it was interesting because most people that I know, they don't take Cold FX every single day for 2 to 6 months. They take it when they start feeling a cold coming on. It advertised that it was for immediate relief. Well, how are they advertising that if they've only ever studied that it's you have to use it for 2 to 6 months? So we got an interview with Don Cherry and explained what we had found. And I probably should have brought my boxing gloves to that interview because it was a little bit, you know, duck and cover. But he didn't care. What he said was, it works for me. Science schmience, I think, were his words. And, you know, you have Don Cherry saying it's great. He's saying the hockey players all use it. That's awesome. So that, again, gives credibility. And people are willing to listen to somebody that they trust more than they are to the scientists we had in our story, you know, wearing lab coats and you know, speaking the truth, but not as interesting as the hockey commentator. So did we affect sales of that product? I don't know, you know, but we did our best to show that just having a celebrity championing your product does not mean that there's necessarily any value to it. We did try to get an interview with Dr. Oz 2 years ago for another story, and his people said absolutely not, no. But first they said yes, because we were Canadian. Then we think they Googled Marketplace, and the next thing you know, we didn't have an interview anymore. And I mentioned earlier one thing that Cold Effects did. The makers of it were very clever. They knew when our program was airing, and they bought the ads that ran on Marketplace during our show. So we sort of went, oh, you know, there's a firewall between our show, editorial, and sales, as there should be. But a little heads up would have been good to know. They also bought the ad online. When you click on it to watch it, you have to watch the 30-second Cold Effects ad first. So I'm sure they all had a good laugh about that one as our program aired. And I should add, Cold Effects has been licensed as a natural health product by Health Canada. Which brings me to the job of our federal regulator. So Health Canada does do a lot of good work, some important work that I think should be recognized. But one of the places that I think it fails to protect Canadians is the way it regulates natural health products. And by that I mean by licensing them. Somewhere along the line, it was determined that if you get a health product, a Health Canada license for your product, it means it is safe and effective. And so we asked for numbers, and we learned that Health Canada has licensed thousands of natural health products. They are hugely popular. Canadians spend about $2.4 billion on natural and homeopathic products, and they are not just on health food store shelves, as I mentioned. They're mixed in on drugstore shelves right next to products that have actual scientific research behind them. And so we wanted to know, what does it take to get a Health Canada license? So we decided to go through the process ourselves and apply for a license for a product that we were going to make up. And we consulted with our legal department, and they said, yeah, fine, you can give it a shot, as long as you say in the story that, you know, you be very clear, you have no intention of selling this product. And so with no scientists on our team, we sent to work trying to get a product licensed. And here's how we started that story.
Our position.
We're looking good.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
We're on the set of a commercial for a new product, Night On, a children's remedy for fever and pain.
You're just taking it right out of frame?
Okay.
The set is dressed. Actors are in place.
And we're rolling.
And this mom, she'll be making a convincing pitch.
So I'm giving him the pills, he's taking them out of my hand.
Night On claims to be effective. Looks real, but we made it up to find out if approval from Health Canada is a license to deceive.
So, as you can tell, we had some fun. You know, we created this natural product called Night On, which is an anagram for nothing because it was homeopathic, so there was nothing in it. Oh yes, we got a good chuckle out of that one. And what we learned is that really the standards for licensing a natural health product in Canada fall far short of conventional medicines. You just have to show that the ingredients used in your product have been mentioned in a homeopathic encyclopedia. And so in this story, there's a scene of me heading off to the University of Ottawa and hauling out this old dusty homeopathic encyclopedia and looking up two ingredients that were herbs that were used. One claimed to treat pain, one claimed to treat fever. I photocopy those pages, send them off to Health Canada with some other paperwork, and we get the license. So, you know, I think just being able to show that process and to show that a bunch of people in TV were able to get a license for a natural health product was kind of crazy. And one of the things that we did in our story while we were waiting to hear from Health Canada was that we played this commercial for a focus group of parents, and we asked them what is important to you when you are looking for a cold and cough remedy for your children. And this is what they said.
These parents like the promise of natural relief without the side effects of some drugs.
I like that it's alcohol-free.
Definitely the gluten-free. Nice to see some options if, you know, you're eliminating certain things.
They also like Health Canada's stamp of approval, numbers that mean Health Canada has licensed a remedy as safe and effective.
Yeah, it's definitely important.
It's important because obviously you know that they've passed all the tests before they can go on the shelf.
You know, I don't have a background in pharmaceuticals. I need someone to be looking out for my best interests.
So what's it take to get a license from Health Canada and make claims like relieves fever and pain? To find out, we're going to try to get a license for our own natural health product. We're calling it Night On.
Did I mention that means nothing? So, you know, the clip, there's a woman who says, well, we need someone who's looking out for us, someone who's protecting us, and that, they think, is Health Canada. You know, so we put these parents in the story not to make them look foolish, but to demonstrate how concerned parents are when they're going out to the store, your kid is sick, and to show how much credibility a product gets when it has been licensed by Health Canada. I mean, did you see them oohing and, oh, well, this one's good, this one's got a license. It means it's safe and effective. So we also looked at a couple of other natural health products in the course of this story. One of them is a popular seller at this time of year, and it claims to fight colds as well, only this one is homeopathic as well. It's called acylococcinum. And it is actually a very popular homeopathic cold remedy being sold in Canada. And it's also the subject of a class action lawsuit. So we were interested in that because the gist of the lawsuit was that people bought this product and then they felt duped, that they were not actually getting a cold remedy. And the judge threw out the case because they said Health Canada had approved it. And because it had been approved as being effective, these people did not have a lawsuit. So it just goes to show you, you know, the consequences that this license can have. And you can see why so many products want this Health Canada license, because it just lends an air of legitimacy to an industry that is making unsubstantiated claims. And it allows people, unfortunately, to be duped. They think that these products have met a standard, and they haven't. The other product that we investigated on this show, and I'm not going to show you that because it's just so painful and gross, but it was a mosquito repellent, MozzieQ, that claimed if you took this little sugar pill, it would, you know, prevent you from getting bitten. And so I took one for the team and went to a university where they had a mosquito lab, and they had a cage full of mosquitoes, and I stuck my arm in for 5 minutes, and then they counted up the mosquitoes, and then I took MozzieQ, this homeopathic remedy that was going to prevent me from mosquitoes, waited the 30 minutes that I was told to, and then stuck my other arm back in a fresh cage of mosquitoes, and then we counted them up to see if I was protected, and I was not. I had the same number of bites, 150 in total. Yes, I didn't sleep for 4 days. I just did this. Even Benadryl wasn't enough to stop 150 mosquito bites from itching. You know, and we laugh, but you have to remember that there is a mosquito-borne illness out there, West Nile virus, and that some people might think that this is a good option if you don't want to use the lotions and the potions or those coils that I'm not even sure how effective they are anyhow, that they might take this and think they're protected and they're not. Which would be the case for our Night-On product that is supposed to treat fever. If you're a parent and you're giving that to a child and that their fever goes untreated, that can have potentially serious consequences. So when we asked Health Canada why we got this license, they wouldn't give us an interview, but they said, well, we license things that are low risk. And doctors, you know, would beg to differ and say that some of these products are not low risk and that we need to have a better standard for them. I should say that a few months after that story aired, Health Canada has now changed the rules. And so for cough and kid products, cough and cold products for kids under 12, you're no longer allowed to make claims that are unsubstantiated. They have to have some scientific evidence behind them. So that's a change that's happened in Canada, and it's something that we're very, very proud of. I guess big picture, why does exposing all of this quackery matter? You know, besides the fact that Canadians are spending money on things that are basically ineffective, you know, believing claims that can't be unsubstantiated. Proponents of things like naturopathy, like homeopathy, say that really we need choice. Why be so limiting? That, you know, we are all adults, we can make these choices for ourselves, diversity is good, and you have practitioners within the alternative field, acupuncturists, chiropractors, homeopaths, as we've seen, all supporting these alternative health treatments. So pseudoscience compared to mainstream medicine can be very touchy-feely. You know, it, as we've heard, it can work in mysterious ways. It's not sort of, it's not gritty the way conventional health can be, and where you say, well, try this drug. You know, the research shows that it works in a certain percentage of the population. You know, they make claims that are almost guaranteed, and so you can see why it would be wildly appealing, particularly if you're ill or desperately ill. And that is why it matters. You know, if there was a banner over the alternative remedies that said, you know, won't do a damn thing, but you're welcome to spend your money on these products, well, that would be one thing. But of course, there is no such banner, and our provincial governments are giving a lot of these alternative treatments an air of legitimacy by regulating them. You know, if it's regulated, there must be something to it, right? Our federal government is allowing bogus remedies to be sold and licensing them, so no wonder people believe. And that, I think, is the biggest tragedy of all, that Canadians in the room, you might remember the case of Ezekiel Stefan. He was a 19-month-old toddler from Alberta who died 4 years ago from meningitis. And his parents gave him naturopathic treatments like echinacea tincture, even though a nurse had told these parents that they thought their toddler had meningitis. They were urged to bring him to see a doctor. And instead, they blended up spicy shakes with cayenne pepper in them and gave him other natural remedies instead of giving him intravenous treatments and pain relief. You know, and it was a tragedy. You can imagine how painful that would have been for him. And his parents were well-meaning but misinformed. Would conventional medicines have saved Ezekiel's life? We don't know, because his parents didn't try them out. But we do know he didn't get the standard of care that children who can't speak for themselves deserve. And so his parents were found guilty of failing to provide the necessities of life, and they went to jail. Of course, there was a big protest around that. People saying Big Pharma had won, that this was an atrocity, that parents were being jailed when they were trying to care for their son. But I think there has to be some protection for people who are well-meaning but victims of pseudoscience. And that is why, as journalists, we have a responsibility to try to pull back the curtain on quackery, to stand up to the Dr. Oz's, the Dr. Joseph Merkelas of the world, and to say, show me the science and make the science good, and hope that good, solid reporting based on facts wins the day. Thank you.
Well, thanks, Julia, and thanks, Erica, for two excellent presentations. And we'll take questions from microphones as they settle. I can tell you that many, many years ago, about 15 years ago, when I had one of my battles with a homeopath, he said that he had a homeopathic pill that actually increased intelligence. And so he offered it to me. And just, you know, knowing there was a sugar pill, of course, I took it. And it worked, because I've never taken another one since. Yes, sir.
Hi. I'm a journalism student at Concordia University, so thank you both for being here. I really found the talk enlightening. I have been fortunate enough to work on an independent study at Concordia for the past almost 10 months. We've been doing a lot of research and a lot of work on science, a lot of really complicated science. And because it's an independent study, we've had the ability to work on this for 10 months and really understand what we're working with. But nowadays, journalists don't necessarily have that much time to put into an article. So my question for both of you would be, how can we as journalists, working on shorter amounts of time in the daily news cycle, how can we still make sure that what we're reporting, especially on science, which can be really complicated, stays accurate?
Okay, I'll take that first. That's a great question, and I think never more than today have the pressures been pretty big on journalists to turn things around, get it on digital, put it out on social media before anybody else. And if you don't have a science background, what I would say is to rely on the community around you that's able to help. There are lots of people, you know, you spoke to this in your talk, Julia, who are willing to walk you through the basics of being able to tell right off the top when you look at a study how it's been conducted and whether it deserves, you know, more investigation. And that's what I would say, you know, because I understand the limitations of working, well, you're a student journalist, but there are lots of people who are out there that I think are willing to help you until you start learning the vocabulary yourself and learning how to do some of that analysis.
Yeah, and I think also it's not always easy, especially at the beginning of your career, but pushing back on editors to basically fight for more time and say, you know, if we put this up now, it's not going to reflect very well on our news organization. I need a little bit more time to do the story properly. I think that's another tool that sometimes maybe we don't use enough.
The back.
Both speakers gave us useful, important information. But I have a correlated question, namely that of no information or suppressed information. For example, we knew decades ago about the evils of tobacco, sugar, lead poisoning with young children in poverty, yet it took decades for that information to reach the public. One could name all kinds of orphan diseases that are still in that stage. So the question becomes, despite the good work that both the media and the science does, are there fashions in these things where certain things are on the list and certain things are off the list?
In terms of how we cover, like what we decide to cover?
In terms of what you cover, yes, as well as how you cover.
I don't know if there's like a vast media conspiracy to only cover certain things at certain times, but there probably takes a little bit of, you know, consensus in science, building about things and, you know, having maybe the confidence in the newsroom to feel that there's enough certainty and enough weight to stand on in your reporting. Some of the examples you use, like the sugar example, yes, there was, you know, science that we've had for many decades about the harms of sugar, but you know, I think it's only until quite recently that we started to learn about some of the distorting effects of food companies. In the same way, it took many years for the research on tobacco to come to light and really have the, you know, the public make sense of it. So I think it's and also quite frankly, like in medicine and science, these things move quite slowly, right? It takes a long time to affect change, to see evidence be reflected in guidelines and clinical practice and whatnot. So I think that's probably part of it as well.
I would say, too, that there are very powerful lobbies that will try to shut down any sort of controversial research that might come out. I'm thinking of the alcohol industry. You know, the message we get is, oh, it makes you fun and lively and popular, and everyone will be running around in cutoffs and having trailer parties. But, you know, the research on alcohol shows that even moderate drinking has a substantial increased link to cancer, but nobody really wants to hear that message. So part of it is it gets drowned out by the lobbyists and industry, and part of it is editors who make the decision, well, don't be such a Debbie Downer. Nobody really wants to hear this particular study. Let's go with the alcohol makes you fun report instead. So it's a bit of both, but I do think that sometimes it takes time. If you know of one little study, you know, that's not going to get reported because it's one study. There's not a body of evidence yet, perhaps, to merit coverage.
Thank you.
Hello. I'm coming to you as a student almost graduating, finishing my undergrad, and I'm really inspired by the work you two do and would really love to branch into the world of knowledge translation and busting bogus science. But I find it very intimidating, the prospect. I'm not a journalism student, and I've worked as a research assistant in the past, and I've actually become quite discouraged by the research process and the broken system that is like the science complex. And so I would ask you what sort of advice you would have for someone hoping to maybe make a difference.
Well, I mean, I think, first of all, congratulations on almost being finished your degree.
Thank you.
And I think that, you know, what you hear is, oh, newsrooms aren't hiring, they're all, you know, downsizing. Well, that's not true. We're always going to need smart people with a passion to shine a light on something. And if that's you, then you're going to be far ahead of everybody else. You know, I give a lot of talks at journalism schools, and it is largely depressing, the questions that people ask, like, you know, do you get your wardrobe paid for? And, you know, and so right away I think, okay, you just asked me that, I would never hire you. You know, so I think, you know, I wish you luck. My advice would be to read voraciously, to try to get into a newsroom and then pitch, you know, eke out a little corner that you're interested in, because people like problem solvers in newsrooms, and if you're going to be able to file something for them, that, you know, instead of just sort of saying, well, what do you want me to cover, I think that'll get you far.
And I think school newspapers, and like, you're in the perfect environment now to experiment. It's a great place to screw up and quite frankly get some experience early. And I work at a newsroom that didn't basically exist just a few years ago. I could have never planned that this is going to be a place where, you know, I'd spend part of my career. So I think new things are always popping up. It's definitely a changing landscape, but there'll be something for you if you have a passion, for sure.
Thank you.
And what's your name, so that when you're famous, we'll say we knew her when.
Right. My name's Jessica Hunter. I've actually wrote a bit for McGill's, the McGill Daily, in the Science and Technology column already. Great. So
you're off to a good start.
Thank you.
I am always watching Marketplace. I find it's a very interesting program. However, not a single time I was disappointed at the end. Because I find that you need a little bit more good advice from the scientific body. The example to give you, I was disappointed when you showed that you found antibiotic resistant bacteria on biological meat. It was like the end of the program was kind of leaving people in limbo. I have a very good scientific and medical background, so I didn't worry about this. But I found that people could get anxiety about this, because it should be explained from where it comes. It should be commented that I have no answer for this question, but some scientists might have it. And it should be commented that it came from the air, because those bacteria, antibiotic-resistant bacteria, are everywhere. Maybe it comes from the air. Another example was hotel cleanings. Of course, it was very nasty and unappetizing, but in fact, we are all going to hotels, and nobody gets sick except probably people who have compromised immune system or the babies. Otherwise, I don't think that it really is dangerous for us. So this I would say this would need some kind of comment at the end.
Yes, no, I hear your point. I think it's hard to say that people don't get sick after they've been to hotels because there's no tracking system in place. And oftentimes, if you've ingested or been contaminated with a superbug, it can take weeks to exhibit. So, you know, I'm not sure that I agree that no one has ever become sick. However, people are not dropping like flies.
Yeah, we don't
know. And that these things, you know, we know publicly acquired MRSA is out there. It's on buses and
but again, it can cause anxiety in people, which are not, I mean.
So in that story, it ended with 2 minutes of me going around the hotel showing what we do and what I did here in Montreal in my hotel, which was using an alcohol wipe to wipe off high contact surfaces that you touch all the time. Because
no,
in our
this
lab
was
testing,
interesting information, yeah, to
yeah.
do it.
So ideally that's true. I would agree with you that if you're going to expose something, you should give some tips or advice to people to empower them so that they're not just left.
Or
oh
explanation,
gosh.
I would say, for like for those bacteria resistant to antibiotics. Where does it come from? I just have another question. What do you think, I mean, it was a kind of comment, a question, what is the future for Health Canada if they are giving people such a useless products?
What was their defense?
What scientific community can do to improve the situation?
What we're doing here tonight. You expose it, you get more people talking about it, you spread the word.
But
you go
what
home
is
and
the
tell
effect
people.
On Health Canada? Because we can talk here, but.
Well, I think.
What
you know,
can be done about this?
Sometimes Health Canada is publicly embarrassed enough to change how it regulates. And so, you know, in terms of homeopathic products, that's what they've done. They now have more stringent requirements for kids' cough and cold remedies. Why? It's only for kids. You know, maybe they think, well, you're an adult. If you want to waste your money on these products, go ahead. We don't have to protect you. But kids need more protection. I don't know. But lots of people think that Health Canada didn't go far enough when it changed its regulations.
It has to be, in my opinion, it has to be a pressure from scientific community. Like Dr. Schwartz, for example.
Well, I can tell you that we've had discussions with Health Canada on this and also with members of Parliament. And it's not a simple thing because they will tell you that they cannot base their decisions totally on science. They have to take into account the number of people that are employed in these industries. And they have to take into account tax revenue from these things. I mean, they will tell you this behind
okay.
the scenes. And they also have to take into account the fact that the public is right even when they're wrong. And that if there's a demand for homeopathic remedies, which basically are mostly benign nonsense, but not always, they cater to that, that people have the right to be wrong. So there's all these things that they take into account, and they will openly tell you that it's not totally a scientific decision.
Okay.
Anyway, thanks for your comments. We'll go to the front here.
Hi. Thank you very much for your talk tonight. I'm approaching you from a rather critical point of view because I'm a scientist and I have to be critical of everything. One of the main points that I'd like to address is there's a lot of talk about reporting science responsibly, but I didn't see many facts, numbers, statistics presented here tonight, and that's what I would like to see as a scientist. I found that a lot of times right now science reporting divides itself into these two extremes, where one extreme is trying so hard to educate the public about science, and the other extreme is trying to sell a product, which is an article or clickbait, et cetera, et cetera. But the truth is somewhere in the middle, and we're not getting there. And this is a very serious problem, because while I do appreciate public forums like this, as a scientist, it creates a problem for me, because what you're doing is you're trying to reach the public by giving them anecdotes of what the other side is doing, and then they're giving anecdotes of what the other side is doing. And then this leaves us, the scientists, in the middle with our facts and our data, and no one still understands the facts and the data. So my question to you is, what can we do about this?
I don't know if it's true that that's exactly what we're doing all the time, although I do think, the anecdotes that you presented and the way you told your stories was extremely moving and interesting. I think at its best, we're trying to find what we saw in Erica's stories, ways to basically turn what we know in science. For example, homeopathy is completely ineffective. How do you turn that into something that's compelling and interesting for the viewer or reader? And usually it's through stories. So at its worst, we're taking stories that are completely unrepresentative and misleading. And hopefully at its best, we're using anecdotes as a way to engage people. And I think that's what we're trying to do here tonight, hopefully.
But then also as a scientist, how do I trust what's being said too? If I see something on TV, for me, it's how do I know it's real? Because I'm always thinking about things very critically, right? How do I know that the phone call is real? How do I know it wasn't set up, for example, I mean, I'm not saying anything for sure, but it's my point of view about this. Simply because it's still, even though science reaches the public a lot, I still don't feel that people are empowered enough, and there's not a lot of critical thinking being taught to people, as you were talking about with the education. And so how can science and journalism and public policy converge together to make this happen? Because I don't know if telling stories to people will shift the paradigm. How can you teach them to read data? It's how can we teach people to know science a lot better? And this is my question.
Well, you don't do that in a one-hour lecture or in a public forum like this.
But
you do that by changing the system, by just improving education.
So
by making sure that they get science in elementary school, that you cannot graduate from high school without taking chemistry, physics, and biology, which now, of course, is possible. I mean, that's what we have to change. You need to give them the weaponry to...
But people forget. I forget all of what I learned in undergrad, and I'm in biochemistry. If you ask me about a pathway, I'm not going to remember it.
But you would know how to look it up. You would know where to go.
Absolutely.
So you ask the question of who do you trust and how do you know if it's true or not?
Yeah.
Well, you go and you dig. And especially if you have a scientific background, you know how to seek out the primary literature and you read it. But these kind of issues that are brought up here are triggers for you to go and look into it. And we can't spoon feed the public.
But where
people
do you
have
dig?
To take responsibility.
What is a good place to start digging for the public in general?
Well, that's a huge question. I mean, I think it depends what you want information on. One thing I'd recommend is to follow news organizations or maybe independent journalists that you have, you've read their work. You might have an inkling about some of the stuff they're talking about, or you've done some of your own internet research. You know that they're accurate. The phone calls, nothing on Marketplace is ever made up. We have a really rigorous journalistic standards and practices handbook. And so, I think that's I think one reason why we have so many followers, whereas if you saw something on Fox News, you might not rely on it quite so closely. So that too, and there are people, columnists and wonderful writers who are spending a lot of their time trying to consolidate vast amounts of research and to simplify it for the general public so that you don't have to go and do a lot of that legwork. You know, I appreciate you're a scientist and you're very skeptical, so perhaps you're well suited for your profession. You know, but I think that's our job, is to try to get the facts right. And you know, if you get it wrong, people don't forget.
That's true. Okay, let's go to the back for a question.
In the French press last week, I think it was Thursday or Friday, there was a letter to the editor signed by a lot of people, some famous and well-known in the French part of Canada, requesting more regulations to protect people from electromagnetic radiation. So my question, I guess, is to Joe, who we've, you know, it's been brought up at this symposium year after year, and to Julia, who's in the electronic press, if you had received such a letter, what would have been your thought process in order to either publish it or not publish it?
I'd have to read the letter, of course, first to know what it really is. But, but I mean, not publishing is not the way to go. I mean, that's a form of censorship. I mean, they have the freedom to say whatever they want to say. Like I said before, they have the freedom to be wrong. But the question is, what do you do to address it after? What was the particular, what triggered that letter?
I think it was for, it was in La Presse, I think either Thursday or Friday, about requesting regulations similar to those in France to protect people that are electro-sensitive.
Mm-hmm. We may just have a whole symposium on electro-sensitivity one day. And
it would be packed.
That's a curious field. I mean, the people who claim to be electrosensitive really do suffer. Just a question of what it is that they are suffering from. But yeah, we may look into that as a symposium one day.
And Julia, would you have published it, or would you have, you know, censored it, or whatever?
Well, we don't really publish letters on the site. We publish op-eds from people sometimes, but that's the closest it gets, and we actually, we don't even have comments. They made a decision early on to basically not enable the commenting on every article because of so many basically problems that many news organizations have had, and made the decision to try to foster communities through different social networks and engage that way, and maybe eventually we'll open the comments. But if this was something that was being discussed more broadly in the press and it was really becoming something that people were interested in, I'd probably find a way to cover it and discuss, you know, here's what's known in science and this is what people are saying.
Okay, we'll take two more questions here.
Hi, my name is Catherine. I'm a recent McGill grad and I'm a registered dietitian. So I have a science undergrad in nutrition. I've worked with patients, worked with the public. Oftentimes, we get people into our offices after they have researched on the internet about certain topics. So after they've seen you guys, they come to see us. And in our field of work, we do a lot of, in Julia's ISIS guideline, we do a lot of sympathizing with the patients to understand where they're coming from, and then education. I think those are great steps that you mentioned. And my question actually follows up on censorship, so it's great that we just touched on that. I want to know, so is there a way to protect the public from misinformation without having to resort to censorship? Because, of course, that goes against freedom of speech. And maybe one step further, do you know of any projects or programs or policies right now that are acting upon that?
No, I mean, I think we've sort of touched on that you can't start saying only people that we agree with are going to get the airwaves or, you know, control over the internet. For better or for worse, it's a great equalizer. And, you know, the information highway sometimes gives you a bum steer. So I don't think you can really censor, but what I really hear and think is a solution or part of a solution is to start talking about critical thinking at a very young age. It's just not happening now, by and large. And that's a shame, and that's why we're in the state that we're in. So, I mean, I think it's a pretty big solution that we're proposing here. You'd have to overhaul some curriculum, but, that I think that's really the only way to sort of give people some skills, a toolbox to be able to use to interpret and understand a lot of what we're seeing now passing as media stories.
And besides, one thing we do talk about in the newsroom that I touched on as well is, does this person have a big enough following to warrant coverage? Are we giving kind of a platform to someone who's just like a fringe theory or a fringe, pseudoscience peddler who doesn't have a large enough platform, and maybe we're going to help to grow that platform when they're really not that important, quite frankly, to warrant national coverage. So it is something that we think about and discuss at length often.
Thank you.
No, the gentleman in front.
I'm John Hooper. I've spent two-thirds of my life critically evaluating scientific data, and I can't answer the question which the student asked, how do I figure it out? And the reason is that I started as a chemist, and that follows rules, and you can pretty well figure out what's going on. But when you get to biology, nothing is simple. And when you get to genetics, it's even more complicated. So my advice to the student is go and look at the scientific consensus. You've got a reasonably good shot at getting it right, but not 100%. A question for you, however. The most widely used herbal product in the world is marijuana. Have you looked at the pros and cons of this? Because now it's becoming a political issue, not a scientific issue.
No, I have not conducted any kind of trial, Your Honor, on marijuana. No, there are of course people looking at that, and if it becomes legal, then
what would be the attitude of your colleagues if you were to propose that kind of thing? Would that be politically difficult?
Well, I might be telling tales out of school. I know Marketplace is investigating this right now, and it involves some kind of a test that people were talking about. So in the coming months, I don't know what the focus is, though. I'm not on the show anymore, but it is something they're looking at.
Yeah, I think ginseng and echinacea and that sort of thing are not very useful, but when you start to talk about regulating something like marijuana, that ought to be really well investigated, both publicly and privately.
I thought the most widely used herbal product in the world was tea. No?
You may well be right. I bow to superior knowledge.
Okay, the last question at the back.
Okay. My name is Ray. Actually, I'm a MIT scientist in McGill University. I'm an assistant professor, came from Chinese Academy of Science, so this is my second year in Montreal, because English and French is not my native tongue, so if my expression have some mistakes, I hope to get your kind understanding. So as a scientist working in biomaterials, I spent 6 years working on developing natural products derived anti-cancer nano medicines and related systems. And I found after more than 40 to 50 years effort, there's a lot of therapeutic technology such as chemotherapy and radiotherapy has been developed, but the cancer is still a big problems for us to conquer, and I noticed that the cancer rate in North America is much higher than some Asia countries such as China and Japan, and I know the food structure.
Is there a question coming?
Okay. The food structure of Asian countries is quite different from the North American countries. So, my question is, can the media do something, to build some connections between the North American system and some other systems?
Do you mean to share scientific information or?
Share scientific or some health informations. Because I came from China, I would like to think something outside of the box.
I think this problem is a lot bigger than us in the media in terms of figuring out how to alleviate some of the balkanization of research and translation problems that you have, and especially in science. So I'm not really sure how we'd be poised to step in there, but.
No, I mean, are you saying that there's research that's happening that we're just not aware of in the Western world that has been published in China? How can we possibly, because I think a lot of research in other countries we do share. There is already lots of collaboration, and top cancer researchers in China, have been here and vice versa, and studies are published in international peer-reviewed journals. So I don't think I'm getting the gist of what you're suggesting.
Yeah. Okay, well, let's leave it at that. Although I think you mentioned that cancer rates are much lower in Asia than here. I think statistics do not bear that out. There are many cancers that are more prevalent there than here, and vice versa. The overall cancer rate is not lower in Asia than it is here. I can give you stats on that if you like. All right, tradition has it that we ask Lorne to pose a final question or a comment.
Well, both of you mentioned the term critical thinking quite a bit, and I'm just kind of wondering whether in science journalism and when you write articles or you do a TV program about some area of controversy in science, and whether you can think it would be possible and beneficial to try to bake into those articles and programs lessons in critical thinking. Lessons in how you arrived at your conclusions, to try to show people how to reason and how to evaluate evidence, that sort of thing. It could form a way of educating people on that topic of critical thinking.
I think one of the great things about the web is that we're not confined to artificial deadlines or kind of small, we have endless real estate basically online to explain things. And so oftentimes when I'm thinking about what subjects we're going to cover, I often think about, can this be an interesting lesson in how science works or doesn't, or can I use this to explain p-values, or can I use this to explain the difference between anecdotal evidence or what a systematic review is. That kind of writing is quite, it's probably a lot harder, I think, to do in broadcast journalism.
Yes, I would say television fails miserably when it comes to explaining our methodology. But wouldn't that be great? Because then you wouldn't need these programs in school. You could just watch great television to learn how to have critical thinking
skills.
And
you wouldn't know if you could really trust it.
That's right. That's right. No, I mean, I think that's interesting, and I do think that what we're seeing more, are you guys aware of the podcast Serial that was so successful in the States? It's not related, but it is, because part of what the entire podcast was about a journalist and her producer colleague trying to investigate and a murder. And was somebody wrongfully convicted? And what was interesting about it, and I think what really attracted people to it, was that it showed their process of, they would just play conversations between the two of them in the car as they were driving somewhere, and, well, what would you think about that? And so you could actually hear their thought process, and I think that's what you're talking about online, too. If you do a sidebar to an article, you could say, well, hey, folks, ever heard of a p-value, whatever, you know, you can do that. I think television, it's not the best medium, unfortunately, but I do think that people would probably be very receptive to it, and, you know, some of the best, we write online as well, and people, we're being told the values change, but, oh, people won't read past 700 words. Well, maybe 1,000. Well, some of the ones that have the highest retention rate, the articles online, are 4,000 or 5,000 words, right? So I think there's a lot of unknowns now around what people actually want, and we're all trying to serve the master and figure out how do we hold on to audiences, how do we grow audiences, and maybe something that you're suggesting along those lines, Lorne, wouldn't be a bad idea.
Just one final thought here. I mean, critical thinking extends well beyond the realm of science, as we see with the political campaign in the United States with Donald Trump and so on. Heaven help us. Anyway, thank you.
Amen. Okay, well, thanks very much for coming, and hopefully we'll see many of you tomorrow night for an equally stimulating evening.